First, he got his first PhD in history of economics at the University of Florence in Italy in 1998. And then shortly thereafter, he again had his second PhD in economics at the University of East Anglia in London in 2004. Currently, our speaker is an economics professor at the Lucca University in Rome and Sofia University in Lugano in Florence, both in Italy. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Luigino Bruni.
Because I never
end my sentence because I stopped in the middle. That was a huge penitence for Matteo, and then probably we continue today. Excuse me, Matteo, go to Regina, the other translator, for that. And yes, we start at the end. That Luca has prepared, and why are we here? I think also Lina explained us your expectation, but actually I'm quite sure that if at the end of any kind, any sort of congress or meeting or human encounter, your expectation, if the meeting are just fulfilled your expectation before coming, I think is a very is a not successful meeting, because the meeting is good if overwhelms our expectation before coming, because otherwise then we really hope that your expectation will be disappointed somehow, because we'll be much more satisfied and much more happy that we thought before coming. Starting with me, with the International Commission, and with everybody. Okay, why are we here? Second, very few minutes about a reflection on so poverty, subsidiarity in AOC, a sort of third part, a sort of personal sharing about some ideas on the relationship between economy or communion and economy in general and plants, and life of trees and plants, sort of personal, let me say, sharing with you. Okay, why are we here? Okay, this is an Italian painter. Okay, thank you, Luca, for... Maybe just 1 second, we can also stay. Okay, this is a meeting, I think, between Asia and Sea, Asia Conte. This is a quite famous graph that for us is important. Sorry that the characters are quite small. I hope that at least you can follow the shape of these two curves. It's a long run estimation of the share of world GDP over the last 200 years. Then, as you can see, before 1850, before the Industrial Revolution, Asia GDP was greater than West GDP. Okay, can you see? Between the Industrial Revolution and 2010, the West took the lead, and then we were further than the Asian in creating wealth, at least material and economic wealth. I'm not sure about the environmental or spiritual disaster. But what is interesting for you in particular is that starting from 2010, again, Asia takes the lead, overcomes the Western. That is not just a lip service to you as Asian people, but I think this is very important for the future also of our geopolitics and for the future of the capitalism, because the power, the center of our economic system is again put in Asia. That is actually the central point, the central continent of our economic system. To be one of the reasons of why being here is also this graph, because the future seems more oriented towards Asia than back to Europe. We are just the old continent, but the new continent is Asia and Africa. Also, I'm referring to my friend Geneviève, that is, Africa is not there, but it's also important in this trend. Okay, just to give you something. Then, we are here for this simple, also for this reason, because there is a sort of huge
change of paradigm in economic terms. Then, what about the economic communion within this long-term trend of the world? After 25 years, first of all, I think the first word I would like to say is thank you. It's thank you to God, it's thank you to Chiara, it's thank you to people like most of you who believed in the economic communion and started this adventure of leading the economy as a communion. And during this story, we understood something that was interesting about what actually the economic communion is. First, it's an inclusive and evolving process, much more than a product. It's not something already there, already done, like a sort of brand or sort of product to sell, maybe to take and to apply, no? It's a process that is going on. And of course, after this conference, the economic community in the world will change, will never be as before. Second, EOC is not just a business community, but is a community of people. Within this community of people, there are also entrepreneurs. We are not a Rotary Club or this beautiful stuff, but we are a community with many kinds of people. And together with these people, also, entrepreneurs, of course, play an important role, as we see during these days. And third, this kind of people involved in the economic communion are not fully happy with this capitalism. There are many people today that think that capitalism is the highest, is really quite heavy. There are people that are convinced that capitalism is the last incarnation of the Spirit of God, is the full manifestation of, for instance, gospel. I don't think so. I think capitalism has a lot of beautiful things, but we are not fully enough happy. We are not fully happy with the way of this capitalism is working today. Then we would like to change a bit. Then is an economy for all. That will be the topic of my presentation on Saturday. Then I will just is it for believers and non-believers, for young and old people, for rich and poor. Is an economy for all. For all, of course, lobbying and leading the economy. There are also some specific traits going to be. I will just mention very quickly one. This is the picture of Levandringa. Levandringa is another reason for being here. Maybe some of you knew him. He was a former banker in Holland, was for many years, since the very beginning, member of the staff of the Economic Communion. And we came here together in 2005, I think. Remember something about 2005 for the first meeting, international meeting in the Philippines. And we together with the Philippines, with the Filipino people, we discover poverty. So poverty, what does it mean? We knew poverty because I'm also born in a quite poor family in Italy. We knew already the poverty because I went many times before. Brazil, in many countries, but during this journey in the Philippines, we started a systematic attention towards poverty in the economic community. It was sort of grace in the Christian terms, or maybe kairos in the philosophical expression, a particular specific positive moment when we started to see, because poverty has many other very important dimensions of life. It's basically a matter of eyes, to see in a different way what maybe we saw before, but without seeing. This is typical of life. And then this is also our memory, our way to remember, to honor Leo, that actually was very important, is still very important in our experience. He was a pillar of the economic community, but he just died a few months ago, January of this year. And we started something new of poverty that now became a new center that Machiavelli, together with Lorna Gold, are training on. This the International Observatory of on Poverty of the Economic Communion. Just to follow this in a very short way. I would like just to give one idea about poverty, because, yes, thank you. One idea about poverty, because poverty is not just the presentation of Machiavelli that we focused just on poverty, because he's an expert on that. But poverty is actually at the very heart of the economic community. I was living for 10 years together with Gianluca Lubic in Rome, we worked together, and times and times he told me, Luigino, study, okay, research is good for the economic community, okay, go ahead. But don't forget that I invented the economic community for the poor. Then the poor are, our focus is not just one of the elements, because as long as people are not in the condition of sending children to school to live the life they design, the world is not united. The world is not the vocation of humanity is not fulfilled. Then poverty is the first measure of any common good. And then poverty for us is very, very important. Then it's one of the classic photo of San Paolo. But we are convinced that from the economic communion also a new culture of poverty is coming. Because there is a, of course, most of what we think about poverty today is part of what humanity share about, at least the most sensible people share about poverty, alleviation, and so on. But also there is something specific to the economic communion that I would like just to mention in particular one point, because Luca will explain, and somehow also Lorna talking about the environmental issues will also go into details. Today there is one important change in the world, in the capitalistic culture of poverty. The idea that the poor is not just unlucky, is also guilty. This is new that is coming out in the last few decades, in particular with this neoliberal philosophy, that if you are poor, you or your parents or your grandparents were guilty. This is something very typical of the archaic religions. It was a sort of way of justification of poverty in the world, to say, if you are poor, you deserve poverty, because you are guilty. This is very terrible, I think it's a very terrible ideology that it goes hand in hand with another beautiful world like meritocracy. Then, if you are poor, you are not deserving, because there is the kingdom of deserving people and the kingdom of undeserving people outside the wall. And then we think, we don't agree with this idea. For instance, you don't understand the debate, you don't understand fully the debate in the US for the new election without taking into consideration this ideology. In people like Trump and others. The idea that we are not very much to do with poverty, with the poor, because poverty is something related to guilt. And then there is a second element that I really like, that is typical, according to me, of the economic community, is the principle of subsidiarity. Sorry for this is my part of PowerPoint. There is a lot of stuff in. No, just a few words. What does mean the principle of subsidiarity in dealing with poverty? I'm talking very slowly for the translation. Right? It's an exercise of picture because it's not easy. The principle of subsidiarity, the first problem with the principle of subsidiarity is that subsidiarity is a difficult word. That is difficult to implement it because people have difficulty pronouncing this instrument. There are beautiful words like gratuitousness that has some problem in taking ground because they're difficult to pronounce, because also subsidiarity is not easy. But it's a very important as a gratuity word because the basic idea in subsidiarity is that the only concrete reality in the world is the person. Even community is abstract. Let's alone the state or society, because there is nothing more concrete than the real person. Then the real person must be the center of any intervention, any action, any help. Then what does it mean in concrete terms? If you would like to really help someone in need, you must start from a very basic idea. The first competence for living, for changing situation, is the competence of the poor. The poor people has competences. If we don't discover these competences, just we try to help them from outside, giving money, giving something, giving infrastructure, without starting from the fact that the people in poverty have some form of competencies, this intervention is usually wrong and not very successful. Poor people are not totally useless people. They are not just like empty box to fill. But the poor people have some wealth. There are wealth of poor that are very much important for the poverty of rich. This is a but if we just jump this first step, you just go to helping or giving and so on. Actually, every, according to me at least, intervention is not fully successful. Then our way to deal with poverty is to start with the esteem, the respect, the dignity of the poor person. Because the poor person, very simplistic this way, with the person with some problem. And then, because that, today we went for a beautiful walk in the volcano, in the middle of the lake. It was quite a demanding trip, but it was beautiful. I would recommend you, if you're to go there. Maybe well equipped if it's possible. But what really struck me very much was to see the ability of these people to live in that conditions. People like me, that when I was a boy, I was living in a very simple way, but now living in Rome or Milan, I totally lost the resilience to this kind of situation. If I will be for 3 days in this kind of houses, probably I will not die, but almost. But the resilience of these simple, very poor people to hardship is a form of competence. Probably their business starts from this kind of competence, making all their selling fruits and so on. Then, if we would really be able to help be useful to a person in trouble, we must start from the competence of that person. That person is not just an empty box, it's full of wealth. But in order to discover this wealth, you need communion, trust, esteem, to live together. Because without that, the poor people are not able to reveal also to reveal to themselves their competence, because they feel just inferior, or they feel just the only beautiful things are things of the others, or the professors, or the NGOs, or the Europeans. I don't know, we are just poor. No? You are a person with some problems and some wealth. Finally, last 10 minutes, I would like to share with you some ideas why about clients, about nature. Because yesterday, Teresa Ganzon, you know, she told me, I like very much, because when we went to Africa together with Geminia Gada, I started my introduction quoting the dance and the beautiful culture of African people in celebrating community. And Tess told me, but probably in Asia also there are dimensions of life that can be typical to us. I think one of the dimensions I really like, first is the resilience of Filipino in particular, but I think not just Filipino, in hardship, how to deal with natural disaster. For that reason, I mentioned the resilience of poverty. But also,
the flowers, the plants, I'm very much impressed arriving in this part of the world about this the generosity, the generativity of the nature. Then I thought that would be a sort of small gift from me to give you, share with you in a few last minutes some ideas about the intelligence of plants. Now the second part of the PowerPoint starts. This is a very nice psalm about blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked. It's like a tree planted by streams of water. No, the beautiful image of the right man as a tree. Because the intelligence of human beings is not the only intelligence of the planet. I try to read also for the translation in Korean. Next to ours intelligence, there is also the intelligence of the animals, the intelligence of insects, and even the intelligence, different intelligence of plants. Today we know there are beautiful experiments about that in science, in botanics, about the intelligence of plants. It's a new frontier of science. Botany and other sciences show us that vegetables and plants feel, learn, see, suffer, and remember. They decide, help, and collaborate with each other, and they are much more similar to us than we would think. There are experiments studied that when in a bush, in a forest, one tree is suffering, the whole bush is cooperating with it. It's a beautiful idea. But why don't we see the intelligence of plants? Because they are very slow. And we run too much. Because the pace of plants is very, very, very low. And we don't see. But if we were able to, in fact, what is interesting, when people get sick, when people get older, they discover a new friendship with plants. Because they slow down and are able, this is true. I have this is true, my uncle, when they are older, and they maybe start to to appreciate plants in the houses, to appreciate, to see the flowers, to discover the flowers, maybe when you are 80. You live 8 years in the middle of the countryside and you discover the flowers when you are 80. This is not a joke, it's life. Because you need to slow down and just to be at the same pace of the plants. This is beautiful, this is not my idea, but it's something that is going on. Then we can all experience the richness of life plants when we have to walk into a forest or a park without haste, without headphones, without running, focused on only on our calories. Because if we go just running in a park, it's difficult to see plants. But if you go there, in order, the idea of Laudato Si, of Pope Francis, as the idea of Chiara Lubich about the gospel of nature, there is a beautiful pages of Chiara on the gospel of nature, is the idea that there is a reciprocity between human beings and the nature. The nature is alive. It's not like a backstage of a sort of a scenario. We are surrounded by realities that we can be in a reciprocal love with them. This is beautiful. Then we are surrounded by many languages that we do not understand because one day we started to run too fast. Started the gradual extinction of many non-human languages that had inhabited the earth for thousands of years. There is one element, my grandfather, that was totally illiterate, wasn't able to write, to read, but was a farmer. And when he brought me into the bush for a walk or maybe into the field, always he said to me, can you hear these voices? The world of the past generation was full of voices that we are not anymore able to listen. Because we are too concentrated in other kind of voices. Maybe they are beautiful, but the voices of the nature. Probably we have to go to some part of Africa, some part of Asia, for rediscovering the voices of life. Then, trees, however, have a dominant fundamental characteristic. They are stuck, they are stable because they have roots. This is the basic characteristic of plants, of trees, roots. But being in such a way, the plants have a great disadvantage. That they can be eaten by animals. Because they are stuck there, they are stable. They cannot run when an animal, a giraffe, arrives. And then, what happened? This is beautiful to me. For this kind of vulnerability, to be stuck there, stable without movement, they learned to survive even losing 80% of the body. They can start again saving 20-25% of the body. You know, this is typical of plants. But in order to do that, plants has to breathe, has to hear, has to decide, has to see with the whole bodies, not with the single organs. Then the whole body will do all the function that in animals have been done by the several organs, like eyes, this kind. We human beings, animals, have a very strong division of labor, and plants haven't. But for that reason, they can start again with just the 20% of the body saved. Why I think this is very important for us? For us in terms of companies, in terms of human beings. Think about the companies of the past century, up to few years ago, up to maybe 20 years ago. The companies of the past centuries have been structured on the animal models. A strong functional division of labor and a hierarchical order. The brain, the heart, no? Very hierarchical order, but very much division of functions in the body. Also in the company, a very hierarchical structure, division of functions. That was the way of imagining company. Application of vegetable to company is a joint project also with Anouk. We are writing a book when we are also talking about that, maybe in one part of the book. Then the animal model was the model of the past century companies. But this hierarchical and functional organization has enabled firms to run very fast, to move in search of opportunities, to react to stimuli and changes of the environment, to become the most successful organism in these decades of great climate change. Not just climate, but change of the world, especially if we compare companies to civil society and politics, that are very much stuck, they cannot run communities. Enterprises have been the big winners of the history of the running time. However, at the same point, at the turn of the millennia, the environment of the human world went through a dramatic change with the arrival of the internet and networks. It's not by chance that the web is something related to the vegetal world, the web metaphor. Then the new players in market, Google, they use the language of plants much more than the language of animals. If you look at their language, at the way of understanding networking, they're much similar to plants than to animals. The same metaphor of network or of the web reminds us very closely to the spread of plants' life, and certainly not to the organs and animals' hierarchies. And this is but which is the problem, according to me, that still in this new way of understanding companies that start to be similar to plants, but the property rights is still very traditional, because of the owners of these companies, the property rights are still very similar to the 20th century. Too few people own the big players of the internet era. Then why I think is important? Because I'm quite sure that the future of the economy will be a sort of new form of cooperatives where we are thinking as plants, I will say something in 1 minute, but the property rights are much more democratically distributed and not just in the few hands. Because this is a challenge that I really think will be very, very important. But the vulnerable resilience of plants, can tell us many other things. Just to conclude, let's think of spiritual communities or AOC companies. The communities, the companies that have been able to survive the death of their founders or to overcome serious crises were widespread and able to breathe and see with the whole body. If the leaders become the heart or the head of their community, the brain, with the death of the leaders, the community will die. Because, as you know, it's much more difficult to kill a plant than to kill an animal. Because the animal is very vulnerable. If you beat the earth, if you build the brain, the animal will die. Not for the plants, because the plants can survive with 20%. Then, if a community is structured as an animal, if the head will die, the community will die. Then the community and the companies, OSC, will survive if they are not, they are more like plants that think, see, breathe with the whole body. And that means a democratic governance, to be able to not concentrate everything in the leader. Do you agree with this idea? Then if their charisma is spread through the entire body, communities are able to continue to live not only after the founder dies, but even after losing much of their body. If a community has many leaders, many people feeling to be the center and not just one employee, that community is very resilient, because it's very difficult to kill a community in this way. But if you're just one leader and just followers, when the leader die or maybe abandoned, the community is very fragile, is very vulnerable. Finally, even this is a sort of my personal, it's not very economic, but it's more personal. Even the good development of inner spiritual life, this is my dedication to Asia, even the development of spiritual life along the time can be seen as a progressive transformation of the soul, which becomes more and more like a tree. Why? If our inner life is structured according to the animal paradigm, always on the move and without roots, we become extremely vulnerable when our vital places, people, work, certainty, are struck. Being betrayed by a friend, the death of a spouse, the retirement from the job, or a crisis of faith is enough to sink into nothingness and experience an instance of authentic spiritual death. Then a good education, especially for young people, therefore consists in learning to feel, suffer, love, talk, and see with all our soul. It takes longer, but it takes us much further and higher, and we can survive losing 50, 90, or even 99% of our body, and still be able to regenerate from a little rest that is still dull in the corner. What I really think is that this something, 1%, 5% alive, can be our work. Why? To get out alive from moments of great crisis, moral or physical, it can be enough to have a little bit of living tissue saved and healthy, that did not devour, has been eaten by predators, and rise again. Many times, this is my experience, this something living is simply our job. We return to the office destroyed by misfortune, after a grief, abandonment, persecution, and while we turn on the PC, on the computer, or roll up the usual shutter, suddenly we can feel physically and spiritually alive, and life start again. This is my experience. Eh? Sometimes after a difficult moment, or even a spiritual moment, I go back to my work, and like a flower, I start to live again. The work is also this way for starting again, maybe with 5% remaining alive. Then, work as often the place of the greatest theophanies. I know that Moses, when God spoke to Moses, Moses was working in an ordinary way with the flock of his father-in-law. And working is the place of beautiful encounter, even with God. We have saved ourselves from authentic deaths of the soul so many times because we still knew how much to make a lunch, how to make a lunch, or because for years we continued to set the table with the same care as if there was someone who saw it and felt loved because of it, even though maybe for a widow, to continue to do the same care for the table, even if you live alone, if you are alone. Then work can be, in our experience of communion, the work is a place where spirituality is possible. It's not just spirituality for spirituality. The place is the church or the family. A business is business when we go work. No. A lot of people continue to work in the economy of communion because the work is the place of spirituality. During the work, not after or before. During the work, as the plant. Then, this is just a way to share something, not just about the economy, but also it's also economy because work is economy, but just to, as a sort of a way to honor the beautiful trees, the beautiful plants, the beautiful flowers of our continent, of our country. Thank you.